Tributes pour in for American music legend Quincy Jones, who died Sunday at the age of 91. There was very little Jones did not do in his more than six-decade music career. He was a trumpeter, a band leader, arranger, composer, producer, and winner of 27 Grammy Awards. Jones had a huge influence on the industry, working with artists ranging from Count Basie to Frank Sinatra. But his most lasting achievements were his collaborations with Michael Jackson, which reshaped pop music. Paul McCartney calls Jones supremely talented and says it was a privilege to have known him for many years. Michael Caine also feels lucky to have known Jones, whom he calls his celestial twin and a titan of the music world. Will Smith describes him as the true definition of a mentor, father, and friend. And Elton John sums it all up by saying nobody had a career as incredible as Quincy Jones. The race for the White House going down the wire. In just a few hours, polls will open across the U.S. for what has been dubbed as one of the most consequential elections in American history. U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris and her Republican rival Donald Trump both scrambling for an edge in the tight contest. Harris spent part of the eve of the elections in the hometown of U.S. President Joe Biden, Scranton, Pennsylvania.
We're going to keep doing this work with the optimism that it requires to be strong. Everyone here knows, in the context of your family, in your life, when you believe something is possible, you put in the hard work, and you know it's good work. Hard work is good work. It's joyful work, and we get the job done. Let's get this done.
Harris will campaign in five Pennsylvania cities, ending with a rally in front of the Philadelphia Museum of Art, which will include performances by Lady Gaga, Ricky Martin, and Oprah Winfrey. Pennsylvania is the biggest prize among the battleground states, with 19 electoral college votes. Analysts say Harris needs to win about 45 electoral votes on top of the states she is expected to win easily to capture the White House. Trump would need about 51. Former U.S. President Donald Trump also made a final pitch in the swing state of North Carolina. There, Trump once again predicted victory. He also urged his supporters to go out and vote. After North Carolina, Trump will also head to Pennsylvania and Michigan.
They have an expression. I hate the expression, actually, but it's ours to lose. Does that make sense to you? It's ours to lose. If we get everybody out and vote, there's not a thing they can do.
The Stevens North America Bureau is also on top of monitoring the developments in the U.S. elections and the Filipino vote. Our correspondent, Henny Espinosa, filed this report.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America. With just hours to go before Election Day, a new poll from the New York Times Siena College shows U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris overtaking former President Donald Trump in four key battleground states in a poll of voters. The poll shows Harris leading Trump in Nevada, North Carolina, Wisconsin, and Georgia. Trump leads in just one of the seven swing states, Arizona. The two presidential candidates are tied in Michigan and Pennsylvania. The poll results are within the margin of error, which means there is no clear leader in the race. Both candidates are focusing their last-ditch efforts on winning more than 90 electoral votes across seven swing states, which are expected to be pivotal in the race for the White House.
And I will bring back the American dream, and we'll bring it back stronger than ever before. But this is all you need to know. Kamala broke it, and we will fix it, and we're going to fix it.
In one of the most consequential elections of our lifetime, and we have momentum. It is on our side. Can you feel it?
On the eve of Election Day, both candidates are holding dueling rallies in Pennsylvania. The Keystone State was key in the 2020 U.S. presidential election that sealed Joe Biden's win over Donald Trump by only 1.2% of the state's votes.
And with a tight 2024 presidential race, Philadelphia Phil-Am community leader Chris Rivera says securing Pennsylvania's 19 electoral votes could mean a presidential win.
It's boiling down to possibly Pennsylvania swinging the entire election.
Pennsylvania is home to more than 30,000 Filipino-Americans with diverse political inclinations.
I'd probably say I'd be voting for Harris because I feel she knows what she's doing, that she's building bridges rather than breaking them down.
This Filipina is voting for Trump because she agrees with his plan for a mass deportation of immigrants, including the estimated 1 million undocumented Filipinos in America.
Dapat paghirapan din nila yung kaparis ng hinirap. Pinaghirapan namin noon na dumaan kami sa butas ng karayong para nag-lawyer ako lahat. Ginawa kong lahat ng paraan para maging legal.
Immigration remains a top issue in the U.S. presidential race, particularly in the swing state of Arizona, where there are over 453,000 undocumented immigrants.
Since Kamala and Biden has opened up the borders, you know, we have a ton of crime in the border cities.
When it comes to immigration, Filipino-Americans have the longest visa wait times.
Arizona is home to nearly 80,000 Filipinos, comprising the largest Asian-American group in the state, where 11 electoral votes are at stake.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.
Spain sends more troops to flood-hit Valencia region. About 5,000 soldiers arrived over the weekend to help distribute aid, clean up streets, and guard against looters. Another 2,500 will be joining them soon. A warship carrying trucks with food and water has also arrived in Valencia port, ready to provide medical care with a surgery room should it be necessary. The assistance comes as anger continues to mount over the official handling of the disaster. The death toll from Spain's worst flash floods in modern history has climbed to 217 as rescuers continue to search for the bodies of the missing. The United States yet to see a significant turnaround in aid reaching Palestinians in northern Gaza. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken and Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin wrote to Israeli officials last month demanding concrete measures to address the worsening situation in the enclave. The letter outlines specific steps Israel must take within 30 days, including enabling a minimum of 350 trucks to enter Gaza per day, and instituting pauses in fighting to allow aid delivery.
They certainly do not have a passenger. They have failed, or I said they have failed to implement all of the things that we recommend in that letter. Now, that said, we are not at the end of the 30-day period,
okay,
and it's not the end of the semester.
State Department says Blinken is expected to further talk with Israeli officials to discuss the steps they have already taken and what more they can do. The U.S. calling out Russia and China at the United Nations Security Council for emboldening the North Korea to further violate U.N. sanctions. The 15-member council was meeting over Pyongyang's test launch last week of an intercontinental ballistic missile. The U.S. ambassador to the U.N. says Russia and China prevented the council from issuing a statement of condemnation.
We are here again today because two members of this council, China and Russia, have repeatedly shielded the DPRK, contributing to the normalization of these tests and emboldening the DPRK to further violate this council's sanctions and resolutions. Despite being permanent members of this council, Russia and China have shamelessly protected Pyongyang from any reprisal or even condemnation of its actions.
North Korea has been under UN Security Council sanctions since 2006 with the aim of halting Pyongyang's development of nuclear weapons and ballistic missiles.